Welcome to the impact of the Russian invasion on the Ukrainian, Russian, and global economies, a conversation revisited. Let me first thank our two speakers, Sergei Guriev and Tymofiy Mylovanov. Also, let me thank the organizers of this event, the Georgetown University Global Economic Challenges Network, the Solvay Brussels School of Economics and Management, and the Center for Economic Policy Research. As many of you know, in March 2022, these two leading economists, Sergei and Tymofiy, discussed the economic implications of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Their highly illuminating discussion then considered the complexities of supply chains, global food security, the two countries' economic futures, and more. Now, 4 months later, with the economic toll on the world's economies and the humanitarian cost imposed on Ukraine and the surrounding regions continuing to grow, we reunite these two experts for them to give us another insightful view on the situation on the ground. I am Alejandro Werner. I'm the founding director of Georgetown Americas Institute, and I will be moderating the discussion. Let me just very quickly give a short summary of each of the speakers' bios. Professor Sergei Guriev is a professor of economics and director of the graduate program in economics at Sciences Po France. He's currently serving as a research fellow and the leader of the Research and Policy Network on Populism at the Center of Economic Policy Research in London. He has served in many academic positions, and he was also the chief economist at the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development. His book, Spin Dictators, The Changing Face of Tyranny in the 21st Century, is coming out, pretty soon, Sergei, from Princeton University Press. And we're all—
it just came out. Forward. Yeah, just came out, thanks.
Perfect, so perfect timing. And Sergei graduated from Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology with a Master's of Science degree, summa cum laude. In 1994, he received his PhD in physics and mathematics. In 2002, he became a doctor of science in economics. Tymofiy Mylovanov is the president of the Kyiv School of Economics, an associate professor of the University of Pittsburgh. From October 2016 to August 2019, he was deputy chairman of the board of the National Bank of Ukraine. He subsequently served as a minister of economic development, trade, and agriculture of his country from August 2019 to March 2020. During his professional career, he has taught in many universities, both in Europe and in the US. His research interests cover areas such as theory of games and contracts and institutional design. He has published in the top journals frequently. And during the Revolution of Dignity, he helped found the Vox Ukraine platform to increase the level of economic discussion in Ukraine. Mylovanov graduated from Kyiv Polytechnic Institute in 1997 and from Kyiv Moyla Academy in 1999. In 2004, he received his PhD in economics at the University of Wisconsin. So everybody, please start sending your questions through the Q&A function. We will start with short presentations from each of the speakers, and then I will just moderate the Q&A session. So with that, please, Tymofiy, go ahead.
Thank you very much. It's great to be back. I'm speaking now from the Kyiv School of Economics. We reopened. We actually reopened in March. On March 16th, we restored our educational program, in particular in our bachelor program. I've been asked to speak about the economic impact of the war on Ukraine and its global consequences or implications, and also a little bit about the recovery. That's something I think I will add in addition. The war, it's tragic it destroys lives, but it also destroys the economy. The Ukrainian economy has been resilient, remarkably resilient. There has not been any run on any banks, the payment systems operated. The inflation continues to be under 20%, although it's reaching that number. The GDP is going to fall quite a bit. There are different estimates from 1/3 to half of GDP gone. But the major issues are logistics, because the Russian troops or the Russian army targets specifically logistical chains and logistical infrastructure. Then there is blockade of the ports that creates food security implications for the region, and also the energy infrastructure. So from the perspective of Ukrainian economy, the most important issue is going to be the continuation of the war and the blockade of the ports. So let me now spend a minute on each of them. The current fiscal needs of the Ukrainian government is about $4 to $5 billion a month. Ukraine has received a lot of pledges from the international partners, from the friends of Ukraine, but on many of the pledges, there is not 100% delivery. So that creates a risk. The gap has been monetized, has been supplied by essentially the emission, by the printing of the funds by, so to speak, by the Central Bank of Ukraine, by the National Bank of Ukraine. And I think the equivalent of the emission is, is soon going to be close, maybe by the end of this month, might be as close as $10 billion, which is substantive because the total budget annually of the government is about $100 billion. So so far the central bank the amount of emission has reached, or is going to reach about 10%. That has been reflected in the inflation and the exchange rate. We have about 30% devaluation of the Ukrainian hryvnia on the, on the street market, while the central bank continues to hold the fixed exchange rate. If the fiscal gap is not going to be covered soon, with the help of the international support, then Ukraine might enter a major macroeconomic crisis, and the expectations will be unanchored, and there could be panic, and that will weaken the Ukrainian ability to resist the Russian invasion. So, in that sense, it's one of the most, if not the most important issue for our international partners to deliver on the promises of the aid, on the pledges, and to increase them. When it comes to the food security, that's the issue which has global implications. We still have 20 million tons of grain, of top grain, sitting in our storage in Ukraine, and there's a blockade of Odessa ports, and so they cannot be exported. Our current capacity to export is a 2.5 million ton a month. It used to be 1.5 without ports, and it used to be 5 overall. So, we basically lost 2/3 of our capacity. We restored some of it by increasing our ability to move the grain through the western borders and also through the Dnieper River. But it's not enough, not even close to be enough. I talked to a number of companies, agricultural companies. They're basically not they're not planning to have any planting or sowing season in the fall and in the spring as well, unless the ports are unblocked. So if the ports are not unblocked, then Ukraine will not be trading on the global market, and the degree of exports, so the share of the global markets for Ukraine in grain and corn has, in corn it has reached, in sunflower has reached at times 18%, but basically it's roughly between 5 to 10% of the global market. So the market will feel that, and there will be price increases, but also there will be shortages, and they will affect the North Africa, the Middle East, and some of the Asian countries, and indirectly they will affect the poultry and overall livestock markets, because a lot of grain, especially shipped to Egypt, was used for some of the livestock production later. And finally, the reconstruction of Ukraine. Everyone is talking about reconstruction and the need to have big plans and about rebuilding the Ukrainian economy after the war. I think this is great, but we shouldn't lose the sight of that the war continues and there is no end of it in any, and the best way to support Ukraine is to provide weapons and provide support right away. Ukraine needs about $20 to $30 billion for just fiscal needs for the fiscal gap until the end of the year, and the military support required is also in the similar numbers, $20 to $30 billion. If that is not provided, you know, the war will continue. We have seen from the data that recently supplied HIMARS have actually changed the situation and fewer people are dying and the activities, hostilities ceased quite a bit. So the situation stabilized. So I think Ukraine has demonstrated, or at least the evidence demonstrate, that providing heavy weapons is a successful deterrent or is a successful instrument to stop the invasion and to stop hostilities. There are talks about the deblockade of the ports, and we expect that this week Turkey, the United Nations, Ukraine, and Russia might be able to sign something. We'll see. I keep my fingers crossed that it will happen, in which case the ability to export grain from Ukraine will increase somewhat, but maybe not all the way to where it was before the war. Finally, the reconstruction plans are very ambitious. The total damage currently is at about $100 billion. The rapid needs assessment is at $165 billion, and overall needs or losses are at $700 billion plus. These are really huge numbers, and I think as the war continues, these numbers will continue to increase. The Ukrainian economy is surprisingly resilient. Surprisingly, even for those who study Ukraine from inside, like me, but this there are limits to this resilience. And I think to summarize, the ports should be unblockaded. Ukraine needs support now, and the fiscal needs are substantive and they should be met with the help of international community. Thank you.
Thanks, Tymofiy. And we turn it to you, Sergei.
Thank you very much, Alejandro. Thank you, Tymofiy. I fully agree with what Tymofiy has said. As we discussed, I will focus on impact on Russia. But before that, let me mention what has happened in the area that Tymofiy mentioned regarding the reconstruction of Ukraine. Since March, a team of economists, including myself and Tymofiy, have written a blueprint for reconstruction of Ukraine. We published it with CPR. CPR is actually was leading this work. We published it at CPR website on April 8th. And I recommend everybody to read this plan because it's not just a plan on the issues that Tymofiy was talking about, how to assess the damage, how to mobilize resources, but it's also about organizational institutional structure of post-war reconstruction. It has a lot of references to historical precedents, and overall it's a document which sets the agenda for post-war reconstruction. And a month later, European Commission published a communication on this subject, and we were very happy to see that many of the ideas we put forward were actually taken into account. So coming back to Russia, there are interesting things which happened since March. In March, people thought Russian macroeconomic stability is in danger. Ruble was pretty much non-traded on February 28th, on the fifth day of the war. Russian Central Bank closed down currency exchange and stock exchange. There are still certain constraints and limits on and restrictions on trading rubles and dollars in Russia, and some of them are quite major, but many restrictions were removed. And if anything, ruble is today too strong. It's actually stronger than it was before the war, and so a lot of people treat that as a proof that sanctions have failed. Now, I would like to refer to somebody we wrote a couple of op-eds with, who is a leading authority on this issue, Oleg Itzfokie, professor at the University of California, Los Angeles, recent winner of Clark Medal. So he wrote a paper recently about sanctions and exchange rate, and he makes a very simple argument. Normally, if you have a stronger currency that reflects the increased competitiveness of your export sector, right? But it may also be an indication that you cannot import. And this is exactly where sanctions played a very important role. Russian imports collapsed by pretty much a factor of two. By how much exactly, we don't know, because Russia now classified cross-border trade data. So we don't know how much Russia exports to each partner. And so our estimates are based on the partner's data of trade with Russia. And basically we are talking about decline by 40 or 50%, including countries like China, not just countries like EU members. And so once you have a collapse in your imports, because you cannot import anything. Initially, it was because of export controls imposed by Western countries. So you cannot export to Russia advanced technology, you cannot export semiconductors, you cannot export high-grade steel that Russia could use for building modern tanks, you cannot export plane agents, so Russia cannot build modern jet fighters. So all of that, of course, reduce Russian imports. But surprisingly, pretty much the vast majority of Western companies working in Russia stopped working in Russia. And there is a website in Yale School of Management that now records about 1,200 firms that have exited Russia. Not all of them exited completely, but overall, Russia now cannot import stuff, not because governments require firms to stop exports to Russia, but because companies don't want to export. Companies want to break links with Russia so they don't suffer from reputational damage. And this is what punished Russia's imports. But when you don't have imports, you don't need dollars, because why do you need dollars if you have nothing to pay with the dollars for? And so that, of course, increases the strength of the ruble. And so the fact that ruble is stronger is not a sign of a stronger Russian economy. It's actually a side effect of something which has been very painful for Russia, because this decline of imports has undermined Russian economic potential. Again, a lot of stuff is now secret, but some data are still available. Physical data are mostly available. And so one factoid that people discuss a lot is how many cars Russia produces. So in May 2022, Russia produced less than 4,000 cars. Basically, Russian automotive sector stopped. That is very natural, because most of Russian cars are produced with in cooperation with Western or Japanese or Korean partners, and they all exited. Now, that number is 30 times smaller than in May 2021. This is one sector which was hit particularly hard. Other sectors lost less, but still that is an indication how certain sectors have been hit by lack of imports. Without imports, you cannot produce cars, you cannot produce planes, and many other things also collapsed. There are some data which are also pretty striking. For example, mortgages went down. The flow of mortgages went down by a factor of four. Now recovered a bit, but still less than a third of pre-war levels and stuff like that. Now, the most important thing which matters for the war is, of course, not GDP, not imports, not even production of cars, but production of military equipment and cash. And this is where the data are very hard to find. We think that Russia is losing modern equipment and is starting to unpack old Soviet era equipment. We are now looking at tanks T-62, which are older than Tymofiy and myself are. They were actually decommissioned before we graduated from university. And yet Russia is now sending these tanks to Ukraine, meaning that it cannot produce new tanks. And that is because of Western sanctions. So that really matters. But as economists, we know that sometimes if you don't have capital, you substitute it with labor. And this is where cash comes in handy. So Vladimir Putin, contrary to many experts' expectations, has not announced mass mobilization. Why? Because he knows it's not going to be popular. Instead, he pays people to go to Ukraine. So basically he recruits soldiers. Even there, things are not easy. And we saw that it used to be a limit of 40 years of age, and people over 40 would not be able to go even for pay to Russian army. That limit was removed. This is where cash matters in the following sense. Vladimir Putin getting petrodollars from Europe. Half of Russian oil and gas goes to Europe. Getting petrodollars from Europe, Vladimir Putin recruits those soldiers and send them to Ukraine. And the way he does that, he pays pretty much 10 times average salary in poor Russian regions. And that, of course, suffices to recruit very poor, usually less educated men and send them to Ukraine. And this is why sanctions are so important. It is important to stop the influx of dollars, of euros to Putin's budget so he can recruit more soldiers and inflict more damage on Ukraine. And we've made this argument since March pretty much every week. And on the last day of spring, May 31st, European Council said that they will introduce embargo, and this embargo will start in December, which unfortunately is good news for Putin until December. When you introduce an oil embargo, prices today, before the embargo kicks in, prices today go up. But the embargo is still not yet in place. So Putin is actually getting more money before December than he would have without embargo. And that's why I think it is important to impose something like price cap or oil tariff. Economists usually don't like price cap because that is something which is non-market, but we actually impose price cap when we face a monopolist. And so that's exactly the situation. OPEC Plus is a monopoly and Gazprom is a monopoly in Europe. So I don't see anything strange about this idea of price cap. It's extremely hard and it takes a lot of effort and coordination to enforce it. Still, it's an idea that can be implemented. And I'm happy to talk more about price cap if you have questions. I think it's a very, very interesting idea. Oil tariff, again, people would say, why do we introduce a tax when oil prices are high already? Well, the answer is we have an externality. When we buy coal, we know that we need to pay a carbon tax because fossil fuels destroy environment. When you buy Russian oil, there is also an externality that Tymofiy was talking about. This is the externality of destroying Ukraine. This is a blood externality. For each dollar you send to Ukraine, there is a dollar or more that we'll need to pay in reconstruction. So Tymofiy is making this argument often. He says, you've paid so much for Russian oil and Russia has used this money to inflict $100 billion of destruction. So it's a huge blood externality. And this $100 billion is just material cost, right? We don't talk about the human cost, which probably runs in tens of thousands of dead, millions of displaced, and so on. So I think this is why before December, people need to think about this issue very, very carefully. But whatever happens, if we make it to December, and that is going to be tough, costly for Europe, for Ukraine, and only then, if oil embargo is in place and it is properly enforced, only then Putin will face this issue that he may run out of cash. Because right now he's running a huge current account surplus. He doesn't import anything. Oil prices are high. So in the second quarter of 2022, Putin ran a current account surplus of $70 billion. That's never happened in history of Russia. This is the biggest record surplus that he's running. And the West has frozen the reserves of the central bank. Literally $300 billion were frozen. With a quarterly surplus of $70 billion, Putin will get this $300 back through this. And in that sense, when embargo is finally introduced, Putin will still have a pile of cash that he will earn during this period for financing his mercenaries that he can send to Ukraine. So that's where we are. Now, quickly about Russian economy. So in March, there was a projection that Russian economy will collapse by about 10%. This is what World Bank, IMF, EBRD predicted. Occasionally it was 8%, occasional 10%. Russian official forecast was also 8 to 10%. Now there is a moderation of this forecast. Now minus 10 or minus 8 is actually the worst recession in the last 30 years. And part of that is due to lack of imports, right? Now official forecasts are now becoming more optimistic. And the consensus forecast of Russian economists, they're not very objective, they're not very well informed, especially given that we don't have data, but the forecasts are actually improving. And the forecasts are moving in the area of 6 to 7%. I should say that much of that will depend on whether the West gets its act together and introduces a price cap or not. But currently the situation doesn't seem to be as bad, exactly because the sanctions on Russian oil and gas don't seem to be as tough as they were expected a couple of months ago. And so this is where we are. But overall Russian economy is going into becoming a giant North Korea or Iran, and we shouldn't expect it to become a much stronger innovative economy. The same group of people who didn't manage to reform it and create a highly productive modern economy is going to try to do it without the benefits of cooperation with the global economy, so it's not going to be easy. But overall, so far, unfortunately, without actual sanctions right here and right now, Putin has too much of oil and gas revenues to continue this war. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sergei. I don't know, Tymofiy, if you want to add something, or we just move to the Q&A.
I'm good. Let's move to Q&A.
Perfect. Thanks. So we have, a bunch of questions. Let me try to group them somehow. I mean, I think for both of you, there's a question on how the war ends. So scenarios for the future and for the end of this conflict. Let me then group some of them that I think are more oriented to Tymofiy. What is a realistic assessment of Ukraine being able to resist a long-term conflict? Are there any, what are the success stories of measures applied in Ukraine after the invasion? There's a question on reconstruction and corruption. Is there any plan to set up some kind of interim institutional setup to avoid corruption, basically undermining the rebuilding efforts? So let's start with those, and then I'll put a portfolio of questions for Sergei.
All right, so let me start with the how long Ukraine can continue in the current mode. It has mobilized, Ukraine has mobilized maybe up to 1 million people, totally are in the military and other troops. So this is very substantive. And with the recent heavy weaponry being supplied by the West, with HIMARS in particular, Ukraine has been able to target command centers and resupply units. Although there are reports that the Russian troops are now moving their resupply bases further away from the front lines, and then, including somewhere at some areas, in some areas even to the Russian territory. So that in any case, Ukraine has been able to stabilize the situation in the east and has some limited for now, but successful counteroffensive in Kherson. In my view, the war is going to be long. Ukraine will be okay, at least militarily, because the international community and the friends, the country which are friendly to Ukraine and the West, in particular Western democracies, will continue to support Ukraine financially and militarily through supplying the weapons. As the West trusts Ukraine more, that it knows what it's doing in the war theater, There's more willingness to provide newer technology and better weapons, and they make a difference on the front lines. So I think that can go on for quite a long time. If we look at 2014, 2016, the invasion in the east of Ukraine, which was framed as a civil war by the Russia authorities and as if, you know, by kind of Russian-backed separatists, but there was evidence, there was plenty of evidence that the regular Russian troops were present in the war in the east of Ukraine. So if we look at that as a case, that alone took, you know, 2 years to become less than that. We have an air siren here, sorry, it's a rain. Just maybe Sergei will move to answering his questions and I'll come back.
Thank you. Thanks, team.
Tymofiy, good luck. Stay safe.
No, it's, hold on. So I think, well, I'm not going to go. It's like across. I was worried it's going to be just for a long time. They just made one announcement. So I can answer the questions. But no one in Kyiv anymore goes to shelter unless we get what's called red air alert. And if we teach students, we have to go, because then it's a different story. You know, you kind of truly violate. But I individually don't have to go, and I won't go at this point. Okay, so let me just finish on the questions then. So I think the war can go on for a long time, and Ukraine will be able to resist, and the support will be forthcoming, and Ukraine will be able to handle the equipment. And people are there, but you know, people are dying. The numbers are staggering. They're not public, but they're substantive, and this is painful to see. And I think if we receive more weapons, we'll be able to stop this war earlier or faster, and fewer people will die. When it comes to the reconstruction and the corruption question, okay, there are two questions really. One is, what should be the architecture of the reconstruction because we know that the previous reconstruction efforts in other countries and in Ukraine have, you know, there have been problems. You know, look at the Iraq reconstruction or the Afghanistan reconstruction. There are significant issues. So then there is a question of design. And in this blueprint that we have been fortunate to be co-authors on with Sergei, we outlined the 7 principles, the governance principles, and they include that the principles such as that the help should be conditional on structural reforms. It should be very clear a governance mechanism. There should be international engagement. The ownership should belong to Ukraine, but there should be an agency or a platform, a coordinating body, which makes the reconstruction effort transparent and accountable, and so on and so forth. So, you know, there are frameworks. They should, that's not the only framework. We believe that's a better framework. Our opinion is informed by, you know, hundreds of hours of papers of research. There are fantastic co-authors on this. But again, you know, you might have your own view. So, you know, it might be worse to have a separate discussion just on this. But then if we go into the political realm, Ukraine has bad reputation of, you know, of being a corrupt country. And it's starting with Pavlo Lazarenko in the 90s, who was arrested in the U.S., but trying to pass the border with Panamanian passport, and he served a term. And then we have Firtash, who the US are trying to extradite from Austria for years now. Then there is Kolomoisky, against whom there are multiple civil and criminal proceedings in the US, in the UK, and elsewhere. So we have this oligarchs, and many of them influence the government through political means. And therefore, we have Yanukovych, the president prior to 2014, and there was endemic corruption under him. Ukraine has made tremendous progress since 2014. In the banking sector, it has cleaned up its act completely. And we have seen that the trust in the banking system in Ukraine is so high that it just didn't even falter during the war, during the invasion. The procurement system has improved quite a bit with the introduction of the electronic procurement. And then the budget process has become trustworthy. And it was all due to a lot of very unpopular and painful reforms through macrofinancial assistance programs, through the World Bank programs, and through the IMF programs. They were very painful. Now, the risks of corruption are there, especially after the war, because a lot of reconstruction projects will not allow for the simple electronic transparent mechanism, because they will require more thinking, more attributes related to the job creation, social projects, also that procurement will have to be done quickly. So there again, I will just revert back to our blueprint and say, if we introduce those governance principles in the design of the reconstruction effort, I think things will be okay. They can be okay. Ukraine has demonstrated it is able to achieve tremendous results in a very short period of time. But the design should be done right.
Thanks, Tim. Let me move to Sergei. Let me quickly read some of the questions that are addressed to you. I mean, one is, what happens to Western Europe's supply of oil and gas once they stop buying it from Russia? How can they handle this situation? Are they ready to get, energy substitutes, where they're getting the supply from, et cetera? How would the winter look in Europe in 2022-2023? Should global livestock be reduced in order to save on grain supply to be able to cushion the shock on the price of grain and the availability of grain, or any other ideas to better manage the supply shock coming from grain supply? Are we seeing a weakening of the compliance of sanctions? Where is this weakening coming from? It is going to broaden. So a couple of questions on sanctions. How important is the internal opposition to Putin? Do you envision any political movement from within that can actually weaken his political situation? And then a bunch of questions on the tariffs versus price cap. Shouldn't we just use tariffs, that it's a better known instrument than price caps? How do you see a price cap working? And then I will finish this round. I mean, a question on human capital losses in Russia. Do you think this can have important effects on the Russian economy?
Thank you. Just simply 10 questions. So let me take them in reverse order. So human capital, it's a huge loss. We don't know how many people have left, but actually when I talked to European government, European officials, they said that they measured how many people arrived from Russia and how many people left to Russia within EU27. And so we have about 200,000 Russians who moved to Europe. And Europe is not an easy place for a Russian to move. You need to have a visa. And during COVID, lots of visas expired. Lots of embassies are semi-closed because diplomats are expelled. So it's not easy to move to Europe yet. As I said, 200,000 moved. A lot of people moved to Georgia, Armenia. There we have almost 100,000 each. Probably in Turkey, even much more than people move to Kazakhstan. And of course, people who move are people who are better educated, who are more globally oriented, who are easier, have easier time to find jobs in the global economy. And for that matter, I think it's a huge shock for Russian human capital, which will undermine its capacity to grow in the long run. But that is something that Putin doesn't care about. And honestly, we now, when we think about Ukrainians being bombed and killed, we also should care more about short-term capacity of Putin's continue the war rather than long-term economic growth, capacity to produce innovation and productivity growth in Russia. But yes, it's a huge, huge shock. Question of global agriculture, livestock, and so on. This is something which I don't know, and I recommend to ask somebody else. Maybe Alejandro can say something about this, but it's a very specific question which I don't know. Question about internal opposition. Well, there are people who are unhappy. people who take to the street get arrested, and the law that Putin introduced 1 week after the war started says that if you say something which is different from the official version of events, you can go to jail for up to 15 years. And recently we had a first verdict on this, and a person, a municipal deputy, who asked to commemorate the victims of the war. So this person got 7 years in jail. Today we just learned that one of the most brave opposition leaders, Ilya Yashin, who stayed in Russia, was told that he's likely to get several years in jail, because when he produced a YouTube video on his YouTube channel, when he showed the true versions of version of the events and then the official version, he didn't say that he supports the official version. And that is enough to send him to jail for a few years. So it takes a lot of courage to stand up to the regime. And unfortunately, we don't see many people in the street, and a lot more people leave rather than stand up to the regime for this particular reason. Some people do stay, some people do protest, but unfortunately, eventually that may result in them spending time in jail. Another example I would give was Vladimir Karamurza, who was poisoned twice by Putin's regime, by Novichok. Each time he came back to Russia, this time around they didn't poison him, but put him in jail, and he's also faced several years in prison. Gas cuts in Europe. So this is something that German economists looked into right away. When the war had started, a team of leading German economists actually got busy and took a state-of-the-art model trying to estimate the impact of complete gas cut for Germany. And they said, well, German economy will suffer, but it's not going to be a catastrophe. In the worst scenario, that would be -3% of GDP. So recession, but not even of size of a pandemic recession. A lot has happened since then. So for example, one simple statistic, even before the maintenance of Nord Stream 1, Germany and Europe in general have increased imports of American LNG to the extent that today in Europe, even before the maintenance of Nord Stream 1, Europe would import more LNG from the US than it gets gas from Russia. So a lot has been done. It's not enough. It's going to be a very, very difficult winter. Now, Europe is importing a lot of stuff for inventories to store gas until the winter. And it's not going to be easy, but everybody's thinking about this, and I hope that there'll be opportunities. Now, of course, there are things where you cannot substitute gas by other things, like in chemical production. So certain businesses will suffer no matter what. But Germany just announced that it will relaunch coal and oil-fired plants to compensate for gas-fired power plants. And interestingly, Germany does not bring back the nuclear capacity, but that's something that that nobody in France would understand. There is a specific French point of view that nuclear is great, better than anything else. Germans don't seem to share this view. Now, regarding tariff and price cap. So in theory, both can work. Actually, it's not one against the other. You may actually introduce both. Nothing wrong with that. So let me tell you why I think price cap is easier than oil tariff. Oil tariff is something that economists would immediately suggest, because this is something we understand very well. It's a Pigouvian tax. You have blood externality. You need to impose a tax which is commensurate with this externality. Tax Russian oil revenues, put aside certain amount equal to the externality into escrow account. And when Ukraine gets a court decision that Russia needs to pay to Ukraine, Ukraine gets this money from this escrow accounts, for example, or immediately give this money to Ukraine, or give this money to poor German households, low-income households which suffer from high oil prices. So that is something that economists would suggest right away. And initially, I was actually in favor of this measure. One benefit of having an oil tariff versus price cap is you also give market incentives to move away from the oil, because price cap envisions a low oil price, which means slowing down the move to green energy. So why do I think that imposing oil tariff now is impossible? Because oil prices are already very high for European consumers. And if you on top of that impose something, it will be very hard to discuss with the European voters that, look, you're already paying whatever, $90 per barrel, and we put on top of that $30 per barrel. And so Putin gets less than you pay. It's much harder to explain. It's just politically, the optics of that is very, very hard to explain. Price cap is a much better story in the sense that you say, we pay Russians $50 per barrel, and whoever pays more will face secondary sanctions. And so India, under the tax story, India would say, bring me your oil and there'll be no tax. Under price cap arrangement, India will tell Vladimir Putin, my friend Vladimir, we love your oil, but Americans are threatening secondary sanctions on us, so we cannot pay you more than 50. And then internally in India, that will be hugely popular. Internally in Europe, that will be hugely popular. And the explanation, the economic explanation of that is oil price is way above marginal cost. Whatever costs you calculate, Russian oil, the marginal cost, including capital expenditure, is in the range of 20 or 30. So whatever is above 30 is feasible for Russia. And in that sense, it can be done. Now, enforceability of that is not easy. You need to coordinate, you need to impose transportation embargo, you need to impose insurance embargo, and you must impose secondary sanctions on whoever helps Russia to get more money than the price cap is. And that's why it's hard, but that may be a good idea. Regarding the incentives not to move to green energy, I think that the situation is so bad for everybody that everybody is just impatient to move away from oil and especially from Russian oil as soon as possible. So that's pretty much where we are. Let me stop here.
Thanks, Sergei. I mean, being mindful of the time and given that, I mean, both of you mentioned your blueprint book for the reconstruction of Ukraine. It might be interesting if, I mean, both of you give us a little bit of a flavor of what the main pillars of that plan. And we take it from there.
Well, I think Tymofiy has already described the main pillars, right? The seven principles.
Yeah, but I don't know if you guys want to get into more detail on the plan, or we just move to other question, Tymofiy.
So let me say one thing. So one thing which has happened since then is Ukraine got a candidate status, which was a huge precondition in our view for successful reconstruction. With a candidate status, you have a roadmap of reforms, and Tymofiy was talking about that. It also gives you a deadline. It also gives you a sunset clause, because we also foresaw creating a specialized agency. This agency closes down when Ukraine joins EU. And that's very useful because it gives you a sunset clause. And in that sense, we're very happy to see that Ukraine has received the candidate status. So that is a big, big change. Yeah.
I agree. That's a great development. Let me just, I think there is interest. Let me just go real quick over the seven principles. First, aid should be rapid, but conditional. Rapid means it should be done now. And this is actually a problem, because if we look at the recent conference in Lugano, which was devoted to the reconstruction of Ukraine, there was no single coordinating body declared or discussed at this conference. So that is going to delay things. And even now we see that the declarations and commitments of the aid and their delivery is quite delayed. Recently it was on the news that Germany has delayed for some valid and some technical concerns the deployment of the macrofinancial assistance. So these are examples of the issues which have to be overcome. So aid should be rapid but conditional. Then the second issue is grants rather than loans. Right now, Ukraine is getting a lot of loans and some grants, mostly from the United States, but when it comes to the EU, it's loans. Loans will have to be repaid, and debt sustainability at some point will become an issue. The conditions on these loans are highly concessional. So, you know, the interest rates are close to nothing. Essentially, they are symbolic. But, you know, there'll be a time that the loans will have to be repaid. And even now, we see that Ukraine is talking about restructuring of the existing loans, and it's only about $2 billion this year that Ukraine has to service, and it's already having difficulty servicing it because of the lack of cash, while it needs about $5 billion a month. So just put it in perspective. So, you know, the loans will create the opportunities for political populism and for reactionary forces at some point to come to power. We don't want that to happen in Ukraine, even if it's going to be 5-10 years from now. Then coordination. I talked about it, Sergei talked about it, that it's important to have some kind of agency or platform which coordinates. The second principle related to this is administration. So the aid should be administered by a self-standing EU-affiliated authorized agency. Should be, you know, this agency should sunset. Sergei just has talked about it when Ukraine joins the EU to avoid the creation of the permanent bureaucracy. And also, in my view, although it's not a blueprint, this a lot of this agency stuff should be on the ground in Ukraine. Otherwise, they will not be informed enough. Ukraine must own the reconstruction. I mentioned this earlier. The EU integration has to align the incentives, so that's a driving gravity political force. Build back better, or in other words, modernization. So reconstruction is just not rebuilding what's been done before, but it's trying to bring the economy, to leapfrog the economy. The government intervention has to be acknowledged. After the war, the markets will not function properly. But there should also be a way to kind of weed this out or phase this out eventually. And the reduction of corruption. So we explicitly talked about what kind of mechanisms could be put in place. For example, strengthening public procurement practices, mechanisms for monitoring the results, very specific division of, you know, project-based monitoring. So we don't talk in general, that's the principle. We talk specifics, how many apartments were built, how many roads, how many manufacturing facilities, and so on and so forth. There's also should be resistant towards clientelism and vested interest capture, both in Ukraine and outside of Ukraine. And these are the main principles.
Thanks, Tim. Sergei, I mean, you discuss very well the situation that Europe might be facing in the second half of the year, especially during the winter. So what is your assessment? I mean, given the already inflationary impulses that are going through Europe, the forthcoming energy challenge, are we going to see a recession in Europe next year? And secondly, how does the energy regulation policy change? I mean, basically to anticipate these kind of spikes and shocks and avoid this scrambling for adjustment and therefore the sense of uncertainty of the contractual arrangements that many energy firms have and maybe is hurting investment. So you would want to have a regulatory environment that actually allows you to react to these shocks, but at the same time, these reactions are kind of expected and do not generate this sense of reneging on contracts.
Right. It's an unprecedented year, and it's very hard to make predictions, especially about the future. In Russia, as I said, data are classified, so it's even hard to predict the past. But honestly, we should all be worried about recession. Globally, US and Europe. And this is the war which cost everybody, including China, by the way, because recession in Europe is also not good news for Chinese economy. And this is why this war needs to be finished, ended as soon as possible, which means more support for Ukraine, more weapons for Ukraine, and reduction of Putin's oil revenues. And actually, with Oleg Itzhoki, we wrote an op-ed in March where we argued that for Germany, sanctions, embargo, is actually an economic argument, because the sooner the war ends, the more likely Germany and Europe can avoid recession. Right now, situation is really bad. Central banks will definitely raise interest rates, which may result in slowing down the economy or even a recession. Regarding regulation of energy, well, this is a war. So it's not clear whether you want to create a mechanism that only kicks in, the special mechanism that includes contingencies like today, because hopefully it will not be repeated anytime soon. But this is something that I'm running out of intellectual capacity to respond to this question. How do you regulate such complex markets during the war? I don't know. It's something that I have not thought about, and I don't know what to say.
Thanks, Sergei. And team, I mean, lots of questions, a little bit of what's Ukraine's strategy in terms of holding up until at a very huge cost. Until what? I mean, reading those questions, I kind of sense that our listeners are thinking, look, when is the time to sit down and negotiate? What kind of negotiation could be an equilibrium situation? So what are the strategies for Ukraine in terms of holding up and eventually looking at some type of negotiation that might end the conflict?
Well, I think there is an assumption, and this assumption has been exploited, is that that the normal state of affairs is peace. And it's true for Western democracies, but it's not true for the foreign policy of Russia. And we should view Ukraine as an episode in a bigger theater. So had the history of Belarus gone a different way 2 years ago, and Lukashenko was ousted, and there was a different, maybe pro-Belarusian, pro-democratic president, and Russia would not be able to keep Lukashenko in power, then the war could have as easily been waged against Belarus. And the fact that Belarus is under control, de facto control of Russia, allows Russia to wage the war on Ukraine from the north. So the geography matters. And had Ukraine not have to defend from the north, but only from the east, then Kherson probably, very likely today, would have been under the Ukrainian control. So these elements matter. And these are all kind of pieces of the same puzzle. We have a very aggressive, willing to use military to achieve its foreign policy regime in the middle of Europe, okay, in the east of Europe, but which is, you know, issuing threats and orders to the countries all across from the Baltics to Turkey. And that has to stop. It will be stopped either in Ukraine or elsewhere. Just the price will be higher for the rest of the world if Russia wins in Ukraine. I don't think it will, because I'm on that side of people, you know, who said it's going to be a nightmare to try to take Kyiv. And people were saying to me that the Western analysts, the US analysts, that Kyiv will fall in 2-3 days. It didn't happen. The same will be true with Ukraine. You know, Russia has been attacking Ukraine for 5 months and has only been able to take some real space in the east of Ukraine, and a lot of territory Ukraine has captured back. So the way it's going to go is that the West will continue to provide military equipment until the front lines stabilize in one way or another, and it will have to be worked out on the field. Diplomacy here doesn't work. What works is who has strong, you know, who has better weapons. Unfortunately, this is very unfortunate that we live in the world like that today. But it would be, you know, people would be in denial, saying there is some possibility of negotiating a peace agreement, and someone is just resistant to it. There's, you know, Russia has invaded Ukraine, is trying to kill Ukrainian people, and is killing Ukrainian people, is trying to take our territory, and their demand is for our democratically elected government to kind of surrender fully. That's not publicly known, but the president received a letter from the Kremlin on the second day of the war with certain demands, which included something you would read in the news, expectations of you know, certain actions which Zelensky refused to do, and rightly so, because for us it's the independence war. It's the independence from the Russian Empire, which over the last centuries of years tried to control and annihilate or Russify our nation, and we refuse. And we have you know, for those of people who don't believe that Ukraine can succeed, let's just zoom out and look at the facts. In 2014, Crimea was taken over without a single shot. Well, there was one shot, but you know, just by some officer refused and he was shot. Then at that time in 2014, the Ukrainian protesters, the Ukrainian people fought in thousands against its own government, against its own secret and regular police, which was shooting at the protesters. 8 years later, we have a million strong army resisting to a foreign aggressor who is considered to be one of the strongest army in the world. So the progress that Ukraine has done as a country over these 8 years is tremendous. And Ukraine will continue to develop. It will be a strong democracy in the middle of Europe and will be able to defend itself. But unfortunately, the way the things look right now, this will be worked out on the field, on the front lines. And whoever has stronger and better military will grab the territory or will liberate and recapture territory. And until parties can't move any further, they'll be fighting. So that's my forecast. I very much hope I'm wrong. I would like to live in the world in which tomorrow there'll be a negotiation and there's a ceasefire agreement that people will start stop dying and start rebuilding. But unfortunately, I don't think I'm in this world. And all the facts, all the evidence says that I'm right, unfortunately.
Thanks, Tymofiy, and very clear of what are the stakes in this situation. I mean, just to wrap it up, I mean, we've run out of time. I don't know if Sergei, if you want to say some closing 1 minute remarks or you're fine. Okay, so with that, let me again thank the Georgetown University Global Economic Challenges Network, the Solvay Brussels School of Economics and Management, and the Center for Economic Policy Research, and mostly thank Sergei and Tymofiy for being with us again to give us an update and a very deep discussion on the situation on Ukraine and Russia and its implications for the world economy. This seminar, the tape will be available on our webpage relatively soon. And again, hopefully we will not do this. We will talk about the reconstruction, but if not, we will hopefully reconvene in 4 to 6 months to give you another update on the situation. Again, thank you very much. Thanks, Tymofiy, really, to making the time to be with us. Thanks, Sergei.